Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of Manga Transdub Theater, where we take public domain Japanese comics, English-size them, and then make funny noises. I'm your host, translator, sound engineer, director, and overbearing nurse, Nicholas Taisho. Once again, we have the man, the legend, the... yes, kind of a scumbag, the one and only Okamoto Ippei. We have yet another story from Ippei's film story collection, entitled Onna Hyakumenso, which you can see right there if you read Japanese, or, as I've rendered it, Woman's Hundred Faces. In it, we take on Japan's early... in it meaning today's story. We take on Japan's early 20th century gender and labor politics in a story titled... 女の怠業, or Women on Strike. Now, the word 怠業 here specifically refers to, at least in this period in Japanese history, what in English is usually called a sit-down strike, or it's a kind of labor strike, a slowdown strike, where you show up for your job, but just don't do anything while at your job. It's sort of like the whole point is you show up, you're present, you're counted, but you don't actually do anything that is productive or helpful for your employer, and so it's meant to be disruptive. Anyway, we'll see how this plays out in today's episode, so I don't want to say too much about that. So why don't we go ahead and get started? The year's first night was passing over to the dawn of New Year's Day, and in spring, when the gods were still among us, families would visit each other without delay, and no one could find fault in the quality of their felicitations. Ms. Sueko, in the third year of her and her husband's being a newly wedded couple, greeted that spring and again, for what seemed like an eternity, would redevote herself and invite her husband to throw back a number of drinks, as many as the years of their marriage, recommending in particular the spiced sake. Okay, so a couple things to say right off the bat. Let's just get right into it. So you might be a little confused by this connection between New Year's and spring. Now, basically, Japan, pretty much since the Meiji period, since the late 19th century, has used the Gregorian calendar. However, prior to that, like China and many other East Asian countries, they use the lunar calendar. And so, generally, the Oshogatsu, traditionally, at least prior to late 19th century, was roughly thought of as sort of like the end of winter and the beginning of spring. Sort of the period in Japan when, you know, things start to thaw and the flowers come out and you get the, you know, plum blossoms are starting to bloom, etc., etc., etc. So that's where this connection comes from. So this connection between sort of beginnings and spring, it's a common thing in Japan. Anyway, continuing. And because of this, her husband was getting more than a little tipsy, so she reminded him forcefully from their genkan as he set off for the New Year's visitations. "Darling, every year you rush off to call on people when you could stay a while and eat. We need to discuss this year's many plans and objectives for our family, so be sure to hurry back as soon as possible. Now, I need you to remember," to which her husband replied, "How could anyone forget? Does it even need to be said?" Later that evening, she put together a number of her husband's favorite dishes, set the table, and sat staring at the clock as time raced by. But no matter how long she waited for him, her husband was nowhere to be seen. When 10 o'clock rolled around, Sueko grew ever more impatient as the sound of the neighbors playing karata caught her ear. Midnight tolled its dong, 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 and Sueko was completely beside herself. She haphazardly nibbled away at the fish and sundry other items stewing away in the nabe. She pulled up her bedding over her head in an attempt to go to sleep, but it only made her feel as if she were, well, laid up. Eyes wide as saucers, she feigned a few snores. Sometime after 2 a.m, Sueko's husband came back dead drunk. He only offered a few excuses and reproved his wife.
How dare you meddle in a man's affairs? Women aren't like men. We have to mix business with pleasure.
On top of this, he tried his wife's patience in yet two more completely irrational but immeasurably painful ways. In the morning, she had to deal with his mud-soaked overcoat, which the errand boy from a local bar had dropped off at the front gate. While folding it, Sueko noticed one of the pockets was bulging, and, searching through it, she found a number of tiny calling cards that various geisha had given him at last night's party. Miss Sueko, no longer capable of bearing her husband's impertinence, ran off in a huff to the headquarters of the Women's League, where she was a member. The following morning, there were a number of ladies milling about the Women's League who understood acutely how men oppressed them, so Sueko found herself a rather sympathetic audience. At the end of the meeting, a motion was carried to go on a general strike, an act of sabotage that could convince their men to change their ways. Okay, so a little note here. I'm going to be using the word sabotage quite a bit, mostly because Ippei uses the word sabotage quite a bit. But it's important to understand the correct cultural context for this. Now, if you've seen the movie, I believe it's Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, there's this little vignette where Kim Cattrall, is a Vulcan, says that sabotage comes from the word sabot, which are the wooden clogs that French factory workers would wear, and then they would throw their sabot into the machinery. That's wrong. That's not true. It's a fun story, but it's not true. So the word sabotage actually refers to sort of the clacking sound of their shoes. And so the idea is that sabotage and the French verb saboter refer to the way in which sort of workers would make a ruckus. In other words, it's about causing a fuss. It's about being disruptive. It's about being annoying. Sabotage is like to cause an annoyance. And I think that's the way in which, given the connection to sort of, you know, a general strike and labor politics, I think that's the sense that Ippei means it here. Observe how a young couple in Yamanote sit face to face over lunch when the wife says, "It's taken you so long to get around to eating your zoni, darling. Your widow tum-tums must be wumbling. Oh, hand me your rice bowl." As her husband reached out with his bowl, a notice arrived at the house from the Women's League. Upon reading it, the man's wife suddenly refused to move. Wondering whether she might be ill, he decided to consult a physician. The doctor recognized the cause immediately and gave the man an awkward smile. So he took his leave and headed back home, where his pharmacist stood in the doorway holding a raw fish still in its grilling grate.
"The maid just stopped moving,"
he said, completely flummoxed as to why. On the outskirts of Tokyo, there lived a junior government official named Koshino Benzol. One morning, Benzol awoke wide-eyed in his bed, darkness completely surrounding him. In the midst of that darkness, he spied two shining orbs. He threw open the door to let in the morning light and saw that the orbs were, in fact, his wife's eyes, somehow unmoved since the onset of the prior day's order to sabotage. Looking at the clock, Benzo realized there wasn't even 30 minutes before he needed to be at work. He needed his wife to hurry up and get breakfast ready. But she wouldn't even move. Benzo would just have to get the day started on his own. Thus hilarity ensues. As he stepped into the kitchen, his bare feet were cold against the floor, so he stepped into a pair of slippers as the water from the faucet spilled over the basin in which he'd put the uncooked rice.
"Oh, how am I going to clean the rice without using my hands?"
he complained. Meanwhile, the rice in the basin floated away, a grain at a time, much to the delight of a rat cowering in the drain.
"I bet the rats are absolutely loving this women's strike."
Benzo stirred up the rice with a paddle and, somehow or other, managed to wash the rice. He put the pot onto the fire, and while the rice was cooking, he began to prepare the miso soup. Unused as he was, though, to having to mash up the miso himself, the mortar started dancing away, causing Benzo to have to chase it about town. The mortar just would not stop dancing. A police officer called out after him,
"Hey! Hey, you there!"
Benzo explained the situation, and the officer, because he sympathized with the man's plight, helped him by holding the mortar still. Benzo searched through the cabinets for something to fill out the soup, tossed in some satoimo, as is, and then got out the jar of pickles packed in nukamiso. As he took the lid off, it radiated a foul odor, and Benzo lacked sufficient courage to stick his hand inside. He reached in with a pair of long chopsticks, which happened upon an old piece of iridescent eggplant that had been sitting in the jar since at least the year of the Constitutional Proclamation. By the way, to give you a sense of how long this is, so this text was published in 1922. The Constitutional Proclamation was made in 1889, so, you know, it's been there for a while. Because of the odd smell, he had to leave well enough alone, but that's when a charred black chunk rose to the top of his soup pot.
No, 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 no!
The satoimo was so hard, he couldn't even chew it. As he changed into his suit, Benzo noticed a tear in the knee of his trousers. And when he tried to close the tear up himself, the needle sewed his skin by mistake.
Ow, 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 ow!
His shoes were covered in dirt, and they felt heavy as stones. By the time he got off at his streetcar station, the noonday cannon was about to go off. Boom! He headed toward the municipal office, where the office ladies had perpetrated their own act of sabotage. There was a veritable mountain of dust on the desks and chairs. There was so much dirt, you couldn't help but sneeze.
Achoo!
As a mere junior official, Benzel was now responsible for providing tea service. Okay, editorial note here. So, Japan, like most developed societies, is pretty sexist. And a lot of the more servile tasks in a Japanese office, unfortunately even today, were largely performed by women. So this is seen as, you know, incredibly degrading. Oh, where was I? Okay, so he brought some tea to the division head, who had a rather sour look on his face.
Whenever men wash the teaware, it always ends up so filthy.
Benzo noticed a visitor walking back down the hall. Back down the hallway, with his back facing the wall. But why would he... Oh, yes, that's it. There's an embarrassing tear in his britches. Seems he, too, has been sabotaged. And, to make matters worse, none of the phones seem to be working. Benzel had been hoping to open up negotiations, and for that, he needed the switchboard to put his call through. When he burst into the exchange room, he saw the cause of the disruption. The switchboard operators, every single one, had joined in the strike and plugged their ears with cork stoppers. At the end of the working day, Benzel stood just outside the gate, thinking he can't go home because his wife would still be on strike. No fun to be had there. It was as if all pleasure had been sucked out of the world. To hell with it. Maybe he can drown his sorrows with a stiff drink. But when he arrived at the restaurant, there was no one present to greet him with a hearty,
"Itashii!"
The serving ladies, every single one, had engineered their own act of sabotage, and the only person left to pour sake was the establishment's retired owner.
You know, if you really think about it, maybe we shouldn't drink at all.
The old man had to get his opinion out, as he barely managed to keep any booze in the cup. To make matters worse, the old man started hounding him for a tip just after a single pour, so Benzo hurried himself out of the establishment in quite a tizzy. It occurred to him that maybe he could take in a play. On stage, the actress playing Namiko in Hototokisu and the one playing the lady Hagiku in Taiju were on strike as well, so their counterparts Takeo and Jujiro had no choice but to strut around with each other. The dancers at the opera house were engaged in their own act of sabotage, and the actors mobilized to replace them had their hairpieces slipping off. You could see the bald pate of the Duke's daughter peeking out from under his side locks. Reluctantly, Benzo returned home and laid out his own futon, only to find that the bedding had had a hole burned through by the kotatsu. So the kotatsu is sort of like a heated table, it's a fire table. Some in pre-modern Japanese homes, it's often like a fire basin. Anyway, it caught on fire. It got burned through. A breeze blew in cold, such that Benzo couldn't sleep, and there was no one around to mend the hole in his futon for him.
Oh, I suppose I'll just sleep with my head poking through.
At midnight, he received a telegram. Benzo opened it to discover a dear friend had been caught up in the flu epidemic and was in critical condition. By the way, this is the Spanish flu epidemic. It's really, really nasty. Benzo went to see his friend and was astonished at what he saw. The man of the house had spiked a fever of over 40 degrees, centigrade that is, while his wife, tears welling up in her eyes, clenched her teeth and held fast to the strike order that the Women's League had decreed. Benzo couldn't fathom why she would persist like this in what seemed to be the man's last moments. But nothing would move her, so he went to fetch a nurse himself, but even they, the women at least, were on strike. Benzo looked for a male-sounding nameplate to answer his request, and brought the man back with him straight away after pleading for him to come. And he was a large man, well over 75 kilos or 170 pounds. So in Japanese, this says that he is over 20 kan. Kan is a pre-modern unit of measurement, and a kan is about 3.7 kilograms, about, I don't remember what it was, like 8.3 pounds. Anyway, so the dude's about 170 pounds or over 170 pounds, which might not seem a lot, like a lot. But the thing you have to remember is that in 1920s Japan, the average height was like 5'3". And so 170 pounds for someone who is 5'3" is actually quite a lot. Or alternatively, that would be a normal weight for somebody who's like 6 feet tall. So you can imagine like a 6 foot guy amongst people who are 5'3" would seem pretty big. So we're talking about relative bigness here, not try not to impose modern standards. It's very different. He was so big, his footsteps thundered as he walked over to where the patient's head lay. Benzo's friend asked for his coverlet to be changed, so the nurse casually lifted him up by the neck and legs and flipped the futon bedding over with a flick of his toes. When the patient asked for his ice pack to be changed, once again, it was much more hassle than it was worth, since the nurse shoved three huge chunks of ice into the pack before suspending it over his head again. He suffered as much from the treatment as from the illness, as the ice pack felt like it was crushing his skull. This presumably human being, who did almost more harm than good, would never let his patient rest, even while he himself slept like a baby. He snored, ground his teeth, and mumbled to himself in his sleep. Then, when morning came, he left straight away, claiming he had more important things to do. And scene. At least for now. That's all for this week's episode, but we'll be back in 2 weeks with parts 4 and 5. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe. And if you really liked this video, you can support my work on Patreon. The URL for that is www.patreon.com/itcamefromthemanga. You can follow me on Facebook and Twitter, links for which can be found in the description below. I'll be back next week with another Shochan episode, but until then, don't let the men get you down. Bye!